So we have a very important way of representing second order systems in terms of the damping ratio and natural frequency. Now we are going to focus on underdamped second order systems where the damping ratio is somewhere between 0 and 1. So it has a value greater than 0, less than 1. Therefore, the poles are at minus zeta omega n plus and minus j omega n 1 minus zeta square. The unit step response will be r of s times g of s, right? So omega n square over s times s square times 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. And since the poles are complex conjugate, the partial fraction expansion can be written as k1 over s plus k2s plus k3 over s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. It is not a difficult, it's not a difficult job to find k1, k2, and k3. You should remember, we did several examples on that. So if you find k1, k2, and k3, and then do the inverse Laplace transform, you will get either with two sinusoidal terms, the output, having two trigonometric terms, or doing that right angle triangle conversion, you get the output with only one trigonometric term. Look at here. It is a damped sinusoidal. Okay, why? Because it has a decaying, it has a decaying exponential, which causes this sinusoidal to decay with this exponential. And since we know the time expressions, exact time expressions, now let us quantify, okay, this output. Let us quantify this output just as we did for first order systems. If you remember the first order systems, okay, there was only one form of response, okay, and it was 1 minus exponential minus at, okay. But now here, depending on the value of zeta, okay, you will have various forms, and one of them, which is underdamped, presents some important characteristics, and they are most commonly encountered one, as I said. So if I quickly scribble the response here, okay, and if this is the step response, okay, let us plot the output. If this is the input, okay, the output should be something like this, okay, and it is, you know, damped by this real part of the poles. Interestingly, depending on zeta, the oscillation changes. Depending on the zeta, if zeta gets closer to zero, if it gets smaller and smaller, more oscillatory characteristics are exhibited. Because, you know, if you make it, you know, from starting from here, from 0.8 to 0.1, if you make it even zero, you'll get a pure oscillation, right? A pure oscillation, sustained oscillations. It will oscillate forever. But if it is somewhere between 0 and 1, this oscillation will die out eventually as time goes to infinity. Okay? If it is 1, there is no oscillation at all. It is critically damped. If it is more than 1, the response gets slower and slower, but without, of course, exhibiting any oscillations. So look at here, depending on the value of zeta, you get different oscillations. As the zeta gets smaller, you get more oscillatory outputs. How can we measure or characterize the system? For example, the form. How much, you know, this is your required output eventually. So suppose that this is not one, but I don't know, 1,000. That as it was the example, you want the motor to rotate at 1,000 RPM. Okay, but suppose that you are getting this response. Would you accept this? Would you accept this? Suppose that this rises from zero, gets to 1,000, and then 1,200 RPM, and then goes back to, I don't know, 900, and then rises to 1,100. This maximum overshoot should be measured. So this is called, and it is stated by a percent overshoot. Percent overshoot. I will give the definition. How much percent there is an overshoot. Okay. This is a measure. Another measure is how fast, what is the rise time? What is the settling time? Okay. What is the peak time? Maybe what is the delay time? So there are some definitions, and they can all be obtained from these time equations. Okay. Now let us look at these definitions. Rise time. It is, the definition is exactly the same as we did for first order systems. The time required for the response to go from 10% of the final value to 90% of the final value. The same definition. Peak time, the time required to reach the first or maximum peak. This is the new definition, because for first order system, there was no oscillation, so there was no peak time. So peak time is the time from zero to the time where the response reaches at its maximum. This is peak time. Okay, let us get rid of this. Okay, and what else? Percent overshoot, the amount that the waveform or the response overshoots the steady state or final value at the peak time, expressed as a percentage of the steady state value, as I showed here. How much percent is overshoot observed? Okay, and what else? Settling time, the time required for the transients, damped oscillations, to reach and stay within 2% of the steady state value. Now, this within, the word within, becomes meaningful. Look at here. All the definitions are here. Rise time. Rise time is the time, okay, for the output to go from 10% of the final value to the 90%. Where is the 90%? 0.9 of the final here. Okay, so this time is, if this is T1, if this is T2, rise time is T2 minus T sub 1. And peak time is the time from time 0 to the time where the output reaches at its maximum. And settling time, the time from zero to the 90%, 98% of its final value. But it should stay, it should reach and stay within there. What does that mean? In fact, the response reaches at its 98% of final value at this point as well. But it still goes on, you know, and then comes back. Okay, we are still plus and minus 2% of the final value. So we have to wait until the response enters this band of plus and minus 2% of the final value and stays there. Okay, so until that time, we have to wait. And if it is the case, this time is called settling time. Okay, settling time. How can we evaluate those settling time and peak time and rise time values? Look at this plot obtained from MATLAB. Peak time is what? From 0 to maybe 1.8 something, 1.76. And settling time is here, plus or minus 2%, 4 point something, okay, seconds. Rise time and percent overshoot is, look, if it is 1.2, more or less 20% overshoot. 20% overshoot. Now let us evaluate those values. Those values. Peak time of underdamped systems can be found from those time expressions or the Laplace transform of those step responses. Since the response was omega n square over s times s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square, right? How can we find the peak time? We need to take the derivative of this expression, okay, and take time to zero so that you can find min and max values, the extremums. How can you, you can take the derivative of the time function or maybe taking derivative in the S domain would be easy. So the derivative of this expression, okay, derivative of this expression would be multiplying by S. S times C of S becomes omega n square over S square plus 2 zeta omega n S plus omega n square. So this S cancels. Then if you do the inverse Laplace transform, okay, if you do the inverse Laplace transform, you get this expression, okay? It's not so difficult to take, you know, to take the inverse Laplace transform of this equation. We did similar examples, okay? So if this is the derivative, setting the derivative equal to zero yields, how can we make this equation zero? This part cannot be zero, okay? This part cannot be zero. Only this part, right? Because we know that zeta is somewhere between zero and one. So it could be zero only for because of this trigonometric term. And what is the argument of trigonometric term? Omega n square root 1 minus zeta square t. Okay, t is outside of the square root sine, as you know. Sine would be zero when the argument is pi or n times pi. And n is simply starts from zero and goes to infinity. Zero, one, two, three. Okay. If you let n equals zero, you will find the first extremum point. Okay. If you substitute n with zero, you will find the first point. What do you mean first point? First point is this. But we are trying to find this point. If you take n1, okay, if you take n1, you get the maximum value. So if you introduce 1 here, omega n, right? Omega n, I'm taking from here, omega n square root 1 minus zeta square t is pi, but at this time, t is now peak time, okay? So if you isolate t as tp, pi, you'll find tp equals pi over omega n 1 minus zeta square, okay? Great. So this is why I'm saying great, because if you know the damping ratio and natural frequency of the system, you can estimate, okay, the peak time without doing those, taking derivative and then inverse Laplace, etc., etc. So as I said, zeta and omega n, they are very, very valuable terms for us. Okay, so peak time, this is peak time or time to peak. How can you evaluate percent overshoot? So easy. Percent overshoot is how much overshoot is exhibited, okay, with respect to the final value. So C max minus C final over C final times 100 gives us the percent overshoot. By means of these time equations of the second order systems and peak time, why we are using peak time? Because we need to find Cmax. Cmax is simply C of t, all right, C of t, when t is Tp. So it is just C of peak time. So if you introduce, okay, if you introduce in this time expression, if you introduce T for Tp, okay, either here or here, whichever is convenient, let us use this the first line, okay. So the C of T, C of Tp, okay, C of Tp becomes 1 minus exponential, right? Exponential minus zeta omega n T. What is T? T is pi over, right? Pi over omega n, because it is Tp, omega n, 1 minus zeta square. And then cos, what is the argument of cos? Omega n, right? Omega n, 1 minus zeta square t. What is t? Pi over 1 minus, pi over omega n, 1 minus zeta square. Okay, so what happens? Look at here, if you come here, okay, C of Tp becomes 1, okay, 1 minus exponential, these omega n's will simplify, minus zeta pi, minus zeta pi over just square root 1 minus zeta square cos cause omega n's will disappear, square roots will disappear, just pi remains, okay? Cos pi, and here the next term will be zeta over square root 1 minus zeta square, and from here the same argument of pi comes. So cos pi plus zeta, this constant, square root 1 minus zeta square, sine pi. What is cos pi? Cos pi is minus 1. What is sin pi? Sin pi. Sin pi is 0. So this term will disappear, and this minus makes this minus plus. All right. So the C max, maximum value of output, can be found 1 plus exponential minus zeta pi over square root 1 minus zeta square. Substitute this into the definition, okay, into the definition. So percent overshoot becomes, okay, Cmax. What is Cmax? What is Cmax? 1 plus exponential minus zeta pi over 1 minus zeta square, right? Okay, percent overshoot. Minus C final. What is C final? 1. The steady state value is 1, right? Because we are normalizing, okay? This is 1. Isn't it? C final is 1. Okay. And divided by 1, C final. So these ones are simplified. Percent overshoot is this. Okay, percent overshoot is this. 100 times. Oh, you need to type. You need to multiply by 100 because you are finding a percent equation, right? So percent overshoot is 100 times exponential minus zeta pi over square root 1 minus zeta square. Okay. Interestingly, percent overshoot is directly related to the value of zeta. Okay. Percent overshoot, this formula we obtained here, is directly related to, percent overshoot is directly related to zeta. If you know zeta, you would immediately know percent overshoot. If you know percent overshoot, but you want to know zeta, you need to take, you know, ln of logarithm natural of both sides, and then isolate zeta. If you do that, you get this expression. So if you know percent overshoot, you can obtain zeta as minus logarithm natural percent overshoot over 100 over square root pi square plus ln square percent overshoot over 100. And the relationship between percent overshoot and zeta is inverse, but logarithmic and inverse. Okay, so what does that mean? Damping ratio, if the damping ratio is the horizontal axis, and if the percent overshoot is the vertical axis, as damping ratio gets large, okay, you get small percent overshoot. If your percent overshoot is small, okay, 0.2, for example, you get, I don't know, 55%. If it is 0.1, you get maybe 75%. If it is 0.02, you get 90%. If it is zero, what does that mean? If zeta is zero, you get 100% overshoot. What does that mean? That means it is undamped. It keeps oscillating. It keeps oscillating. So if it is zeta one, okay, look at here. If it is zeta one, there is no zero, there is no percent overshoot. That means it is critically damped. If it is even more than one, again, 0% overshoot. Okay, it is even overdamped, overdamped. If it was one, it is critically damped. Okay, so zeta is such a significant value characterizing the output. How can we evaluate settling time? Look at again by means of these time expressions, which was these expressions were obtained by inverse Laplace form of the inverse Laplace transform of those response written in S domain. Okay, so how can we find settling time? Using the definition, the settling time is the time it takes for the amplitude of the peaking sinusoid in C of t to reach 0.02% of its final value. So, or the amplitude must be 0.98. 1 minus 0.98, okay? 1 minus 0.98 for 1 minus 0.98, the time becomes settling time, all right? So this part with a conservative approach, this part will be 0.02 if when this is 1, okay? This equation is a conservative estimate since we are assuming that cos phi is 1. Well, this is conservative estimate because if you don't take 1, the settling time, the longest settling time we are taking, okay? So we are a bit cautious. Settling time is this. This term is something between 3.9 and 4.74. But just to, you know, remember from first order system, it was 4 times time constant, the same logic, or 4 over A, okay? If you remember in the first order systems, if the pole is at minus A, the settling time was, okay, 4 over A, or 4 time constant. Now here, the poles are, look at here, second order system, the poles are at zeta omega n, the real part, okay, and the imaginary part is here, plus j omega n 1 minus zeta square, okay, minus j omega n 1 minus zeta square. So this is the real part. Again, settling time is just like in here, 4 over, now real part of the poles, 4 over zeta omega n. In fact, this, if you look at the time expression, exponential minus zeta omega n, those real parts, real terms, always create exponentials, right? And so this is a kind of time constant, isn't it? So 1 over zeta omega n is a kind of time constant of the system, just like for A. All right, so we know we got very nice expressions. If we know zeta and omega n, okay, if we know zeta and omega n, okay, we would immediately estimate the settling time, peak time, and also percent overshoot. How about rise time? Well, evaluating rise time analytically is a bit difficult. Why is that? Because the time expressions are a bit too long, and you need to find two time expressions, okay, T1 and T2, as I showed here, look at here. You need to find first T1 and then T2, and then find this difference, T2 minus T1. It is a bit complicated, okay? Instead of using that or obtaining an analytical expression, we use this table or this curve to estimate the curve, or the table is actually expressed damping ratio versus the normalized rise time normalized with natural frequency. Okay. So you can make use of this table or this plot, or this is what we what our textbook suggests. Textbook of Norman Mrs. Control Systems Engineering. In another textbook by Dorf and Bishop, okay, Modern Control Engineering, they suggested this expression with rise time zeta omega n, okay? It is a kind of linearization of this curve, okay? Linearization, but it is a kind of approach and valid for a relatively narrow limits of the zeta, okay? Look at here. If zeta is something between 0.05 and 0.95, you can use this. But it is more accurate, I was looking for this, it is more accurate for 0.3, the value between 0.3 and 0.8. Now, let us do some examples and finish the video.